Good morning, everyone. What a joy it is to be with you on another glorious morning. Hopefully a little less snowy this week than it was last week. I hope you all were able to get out of your homes and safely get around when you needed to this week. But a few announcements for you this morning. Today is Super Bowl Sunday, and no, not the night that we will watch the Ravens lose in the Super Bowl. Or the Packers, or the Redskins, or the Steelers, because none of them got there. But the morning that we collect final donations to go towards Elmer Wolf Elementary School. They are collecting money for fresh fruit and vegetables to give to the kids. So please mail those checks in to us this week. Be sure to add to the memo line that it is for Super Bowl Sunday. And we know that the mail is a little crazy right now, so we'll be sure to wait a little bit just to make sure we get everybody's offering. So thank you so much for supporting that this month. Oh, at the time that we are recording today, we have no internet in the church, so that's why my laptop is sitting here in front of you, because we couldn't get it to print from the church computer. And we didn't catch that till we got here. So that is why this is here, and Pastor Scott will have his laptop as well. But also at the time of this recording, we still don't have our Upper Room or Lenten devotional booklets, so be sure to pay attention to the Friday announcements email in case it changed between now and then. But as soon as we get those in, I will be sure to let you know. Our COVID-19 Together Fund is still available for congregation members. So if COVID-19 has affected you financially, please contact the pastors. We really want to be able to support you and hope it takes a little stress off of everything else that's going on today. But we also have our benevolence fund that is available for those in the community who may also be struggling financially. So if you or someone you know could benefit from either one of these funds, please, please, please call the pastors. And lastly, a special thank you to Ken and Roy for making our parking lot and sidewalks accessible this week. Again, we welcome you to worship this day. Let us prepare our hearts as the prelude plays. Praise the one who hears the cry of the poor, who lifts up the weak and gives them strength. Praise the one who feeds the hungry and satisfies the longing of those in need. Praise the one who holds with tenderness the orphan and widow and gives the stranger a land and a home. Let us pray together. O living Christ, come to us in the glory of your risen power. Come to us in the humility of your wondrous love. Come and reign among us. Let new life course through our veins, new love bind us together, and new vision spur us on to follow you forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
We have come to the time this morning for our pastoral prayer. Would you bow your heads and pray with me? Gracious God, we pour out our praises upon your holy name. You, God, our creator and sustainer, always and forever, we proclaim your majestic divinity. We admit, O Lord, we struggle every single day to do what is right and to avoid the stumbling blocks that we meet along the pathways of our journey. It often seems silly as we voice our thanks to you, O God. How do our tiny, insignificant voices really matter in regard to your magnitude and greatness? But we remember always that Jesus came not just for imparting of grace and for reasons of atonement, but Christ came to be in relationship with us. This day, O God, we bring to you several prayer requests within our local community. We pray for Dale and Sandy, the Outovator family, Ruth, the Barnett family, the Black family, Martha and Roy, Dave, the Dodderer family, Shirley, Melissa and Rick, Donna, Tom and Margie, Thurston, Donna and Jean, Lyle and June, Ruth and Dot. We lift up these individuals and pray the way that you taught us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture reading today comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 9. If I proclaim the gospel, This gives me no grounds for boasting, for an obligation is laid upon me. And woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this. That is my proclamation. I may make the gospel free of charge so as to not make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with all respect, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became a Jew in order to win the Jews, or to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself was not under the law, so that I might win those that were under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessing. I've got a small confession to start with the sermon this week. When I read this passage, instead of feeling really empowered to preach the gospel and really just feeling the glory of these words from the Apostle Paul, honestly, I feel more a sense of dread that wells up inside me when first beginning to encounter these words. There are several negative characterizations and tropes about Christians in our world today. And they quickly come to mind when you begin to consider this passage. The judgmental Christian, the self-righteous Christian, and the holier-than-thou Christian. And unfortunately, a reality is when you hear a trope, when you hear a stereotype, when you hear that kind of thing, there's usually a pretty strong and profound reason for it. Unfortunately, throughout history, we have seen time and time again, example after example, of supposedly righteous Christian brothers and sisters giving strong illustrations of how much better they are than their counterparts. This, of course, is not exclusive to Christianity, as one example in Jesus' teaching is within the Gospel of Luke, pointing towards a Pharisee doing this very thing. We see the Pharisee going boldly and praying before the temple, and quickly the Pharisee proclaims, "God, I thank you that I am not like other people, like the robbers, the evildoers, the adulterers. I am not even like this tax collector over here." The tax collector then goes up to pray before the temple. Can't even raise his eyes to the temple and just says, "God, have mercy on me, a sinner." The story concludes with Jesus proclaiming that it is the tax collector that was the more righteous individual in this case over the supposedly holy individual. As the tax collector recognized their faults, recognized their sins, and went with humility before God to ask for mercy and ask for forgiveness, while the Pharisee was quick to point toward the sinfulness of everyone else around him, the sinfulness of others, and quickly thank God that they are so great and not like others. I think sometimes we miss how powerful the satirical elements and sarcastic elements are that are within our Bibles, pointing towards the just over-the-top nature in which this Pharisee, looking not only to the glory of God, but in this case, actually the glory of their self. I mean, this Pharisee is so over-the-top, it's not funny. "I thank God I am not like other people," being that first line again. But this, unfortunately, is a reality so often in our world. A story I recently heard expressed to me as a joke by one of my EYN counterparts in seminary. For those that are not aware, EYN is Bethany Seminary's satellite campus in Nigeria. I had a class recently with some of our Nigerian students, and one of them shared a story that the Nigerians say every now and then. I think it's a bit broader context of more Northern Africans in context of the church. But they say when the white man came, the colonists that is, they asked us to close our eyes and pray with them. When we opened our eyes, all of our natural resources were gone, and the only thing left in our hands was the Bible. There is quite the reckoning for those of us for us to consider that so many of our so-called missionaries and evangelists were privy to colonists taking away everything from other people, stripping them bare, but making sure they left that Bible behind to share God's love with these other individuals. It's a crazy thing to think about. When we hear stories like this, there is no great wonder why so many people do not trust the church or organized religion in and of itself, as they have always seen it taking things away from other people. While those that were seemingly the thieves were propped up to look like white knights coming to the rescue, marching in and saving everyone around them by essentially proclaiming, "Your society is wrong, your society is backwards, and you should look and act more like us." The way you think is wrong. The way you act is wrong. Be more like the civilized Christian world. But what is the message that they are sending in this context? That the civilized Christian world comes in and takes what they want and then tells you, this is your new religion. At times when we hear stories like this, the only thing that can enter our minds is a question like, what Bible are they reading? What Bible allowed people to go and make these sort of jumps and these sort of conclusions that they were allowed to take from other people and leave behind the gospel to justify their actions? The words of the Apostle Paul illustrate a very, very different teaching on proclaiming the gospel. "What is my reward," Paul says, "just this, that in my proclamation I may take the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel." What did he say there again? Paul makes it abundantly clear. He is not the one bringing the gift of the gospel to other people. He is preaching the word of God. He is preaching a gift from Christ that has already been given by grace. Paul is just sharing the gift that's already there with other people. Paul is just the one proclaiming the glory of the gift that has already been given and sharing that message with the world. Looking further into the scripture, Paul describes himself not as a leader, not as exalted, not as being in any kind of position or of glory, but actually as a slave or a servant to those he is speaking to. The apostle states, "For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became as a Jew in order to win more Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though I myself was not under the law, so that I might win under the law." These first two examples of the Apostle Paul speaks back to before he ever became a Christian. Before Paul knew Christ, he was so fervent in his desire to bring glory to his Judean God that he acted as much like other Jewish individuals as he could to elevate their scriptures. Paul has described himself numerous times throughout the Bible as a Pharisee of all Pharisees prior to his conversion. And this Pharisaic sect really is what Main Street Judaism is today. It was the synagogue-believing Jewish individuals. Paul for the early parts of his life, lived always within that constraint, serving himself and lowering himself within that subtext. And to those outside the law, I became one outside the law. Though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. That might sound a little bit confusing, but what he's generally saying here is, Paul is speaking of the Gentiles. Essentially, everyone that was not Jewish, and speaking to the context of being amongst the Gentiles. See, the Judean law, the law of God, would have meant nothing to the Gentiles. And so Paul, in speaking with any individual who is not of the Jewish faith, what did he do when he was with them? What did he do when he was missionary, when he was doing his missionary voyages? He dined with them. He broke bread with them. And simply put, he just lived in community with them as friend, sharing with them love. In order to spread the message of the gospel, Paul humbled himself to become more like the people he was speaking to understand them, to understand their culture, to understand their society, and not to break them and force them into conformity. Finally, Paul refers to the weak. The weak is something we might not grasp when we just read the scripture. To the weak, I became weak so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people that I might by all means save some. From the book of Romans, we get a clear depiction of what the weak actually means in Paul's context. The Jewish Christians that were holding so strong to Judean custom that they were forcing the Gentiles to live as they did, forcing other people to embrace their cultic practices and live a life under their law. The huge problem with this is, through Christ, we are told that Christ came that we would have freedom from sin, and because none could live up to that standard of the law. It's like they wanted to go back to the way things were before Christ. And so Paul refers to them as the weak, talking about how that their faith was still so bound up in acts, in deeds, in works, instead of their faith being bound up in Christ. Paul illustrates that while preaching to the weak within culture, he still adhered to their culture and their way of life while preaching to them. He met people on their level. He met people where they were and didn't try to change the person that they were. Repeatedly, Paul conveys a message of sharing the gospel by being amongst the people, living among the people, and enjoying community with people. At every turn, Paul places everyone else above himself and proceeds to preach and teach as an aspect of service. A significant thought I want us to make sure to leave with today. A thought that we need to have in our brains when we look to proclaim the gospel to other people. That we are to live a life of service and not a life of serve us. I'm going to say that again if you didn't catch it. We're not here to live a life, we are supposed to live a life of service, not a life of serve us, U.S. Because that's so often what we have seen through our history. We go out and evangelize to other people so that they will be more like us. They will do things the way we want them to do it, instead of helping them. Service, the word service, conveys no method or message of doing it for a reason, of doing it for a purpose of taking, of getting something back. You're doing it because you love your fellow individual. When we look at the struggles in the larger church today, one of the main issues that we repeatedly see from people going out into the world to proclaim the gospel to others is that we seem to want to proclaim the gospel in our own image. Often in proclaiming that gospel, we proclaim the beauty of our own images, our style of worship. And we illustrate how that is what the gospel is. While in proclaiming the gospel, we should be desiring to compel others to love of Christ. The key is first in loving them. Loving other individuals. Service is done where we meet others at their level and we demonstrate and share a story of love so deep, so profound, and so compassionate that we can barely even understand it ourselves. That is what service is. That is what it is to proclaim the gospel, to proclaim putting others first, loving your neighbor, and putting yourself below them, not trying to get them on your level or on your page. In Christ's ministry, he so often met individuals that were cast out of society, that looked different, acted different, and in general felt so rejected by the world around them that they knew they would never be included. I fail to see the biblical passage anywhere where Christ asks these kind of individuals to conform, to change the way they looked or dress. Instead, we get an image of Christ seeing those individuals that were outcasts. Christ's message for those that thought they had no worth seemed to be, I see you and I love you. I see you and I love you. People that felt they didn't belong, that they didn't deserve anything, were included and brought in. But they weren't included with condition. They weren't excluded because they looked different, sounded different. When we proclaim the good news of God's love, that is exactly the energy that we need to bring to the proclamation. To proclaim a gospel of love, compassion, and forgiveness. People in this world come from all kinds of different walks of life, different shapes, sizes, colors, ethnicities, educational backgrounds, and the list goes on and on and on. And to me, that is all a part of God's design. And our differences, our diversity are beautiful and part of God's creation of all of this. In proclaiming the Gospels, we are to let God mold us into God's image, and not do the opposite, where we ask others to be like us. We want to be more like God and to encourage them to do the same. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, you know us inside and out, and despite all of our flaws and the ways in which we fall short of your glory, you still love us. We are invited into your presence. We are forgiven and we are loved. Lord God, transform us to proclaim your gospels with love for our neighbors, all of our neighbors. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Go now and trust in God's mercy for your strength. Proclaim the good news wherever God calls you. And do not set yourself apart from others, but be all things to all people for the sake of the gospel. And may God give you the strength and freedom of an eagle. May Christ be the bread that nourishes and renews you. And may the Holy Spirit be the rising wind beneath your wings. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of our Christ Jesus, amen.